Hi, good morning, everybody. So I want to talk about expanders. It seems that if you count out extractors and high-dimensional expanders, all the regular expanders are sort of out of fashion in this workshop. So I'll try to revive your interest. I want to talk about open problems both on expanders and extractors, but as you know, lots of the extractor open problems were solved last year. So I have more, but anyway, I'll talk about expanders. You can think of it as a set of open questions. You can think of it as also some survey of the huge variety, and it's growing, of types of expanders. I've written here the types of expanders I'll talk about. Well, I'll define what an explicit expander is. I'll talk about local expanders, Cayley expanders, lossless expanders, unbalanced expanders, dimensions expanders, monotone expanders, and super expanders. I don't know if you...
45 minutes.
Exactly, yeah. So eventually I'll have to make some selection, but let me start. So just to get everybody on the same page, we'll be talking about graph G. They'll have n vertices, and you should think of n as large going to infinity, and of degree d, or at most d, where d will be a fixed constant. So and then going to infinity, I mean, in your mind you should think really, so this is g, but in your mind you should think of g and I and an infinite family of graphs. And when is it an expander? Well, there are several definitions and they are equivalent. Let me give you two. One is that it expands. So for every subset of the vertices, which is not too large, let's say then half the size of the graph, the number of edges from S to S complement is at least some constant times S. So here there'll be, right, there exists a C greater than zero, that's number one. So that's the expansion property. It's a combinatorial or geometric property. And the equivalent definition, which is algebraic, is about the eigenvalues. This graph will have eigenvalues spectrum. The adjacency matrix will have spectrum lambda 1, lambda 2, to lambda n. The first one will be d, and you want all the other ones to be bounded away from d. There are various definitions, but I'll just use this one. Lambda 2 is at most 1 minus c, so bounded away from d. And these two conditions, so all the eigenvalues are bounded away from d. And again, d is fixed. For all these n in this infinite family, there is this uniform bound. Let's say lambda 2 is 0.99 times d. And these two are equivalent. This is the discrete version of Cheeger inequality, which is due to Alon Milman and Alon. So they are equivalent. And maybe we'll see later some more equivalent conditions. What do we want with these expanders? Please stop and ask questions, not open. Yeah, you can think of them as regular, but I'll cheat. Sometimes it will be just an upper bound. Sometimes there'll be multiple edges. In computer science, we like these graphs to be explicit. So a random graph, random deregular graph, is an expander, with almost surely. We want explicit ones. So we are going to think of these d neighbors of a vertex as just maps. So we want maps for I and D. We want these maps Fi from N to N to define the ith neighbor Okay, and the question is whether you can describe these functions, these mappings explicitly. And there are various ways to think about it. So it's good to think of n as the power of 2, or roughly as the power of 2. And then these functions are functions from 0, 1 to the k to 0, 1 to the k. Right? And I give you k bits, the name of a vertex. You want to know which are its d neighbors. So you evaluate these. And the question is how complicated it is to evaluate them. It's explicit if this is not too complicated. And explicit for us means that these fi's are polynomial time computable. They're efficiently computable. Okay, that's what we want. And now that we've defined explicit ones, we can ask how to build them. I'll talk about some ways of building them. By the way, for those who've never seen an expander, I don't know if there are any, but one example that you should have in mind if you want to show your friends and your family is take the numbers modulo p. So it's a family of expanders. Connect them in a cycle, and then connect any number x to x inverse mod p. And if it doesn't work for 0, you can put a self-loop here, and it's free regular.
Is it okay. Minus x inverse?
What?
Is it minus x inverse?
What does it matter? This is by Lubotsky, Phillips, and Sarnak. So, and this is explicit because, you know, you compute the inverse mod p easily. So that's even in log space if you want. So I want to start talking about various types of these expanders, and I want to talk about local expanders first. So local is when you want some more properties of this function, not just that it's efficiently computable, but that it's, you know, really, really simple. So how, the basic question, one basic question is how simple can expanders be? So you have these k bits of input, let's say the name of the vertex, and here are the output, this is fi, so it's connected to some y1 up to yk by the ith neighbor. Local means that every bit of the output depends on, let's say, L local, depends just on L bits. And you can ask, can something so restricted where, you know, each output bit depends on a few input bits be an expander? And the answer is yes. So I'm asking some open problems that were open long ago and then they were solved. There's an old paper of Aurora Steurer and myself where shows that you can have so expanders. Expanders can be three local. And we were wondering, so this is with working with Viola last year, we were wondering whether they can be one local. What's a one local expander? I mean, just a projection. A one local expander. Don't worry, I'll ask an open question even about this, even though I'm telling you a result. And one local expander is where this fi is just a projection. Every bit is just either, every output bit is either an input bit or a complement. Maybe this is x1, and this is the negation of x1. So each one of the maps taking you to the neighbors is just a projection. So they exist. So there are one, I'll tell you two things, one local. There are one local expanders.
It's allowed to be a constant too?
What?
It's allowed to be a constant.
You can't. I mean, yeah, it's allowed to be, but you don't need a constant. Yeah.
So just to be clear, when you say that the function is local, you're not actually talking about fi itself. You're talking about f, the jth bit of fi.
Yeah, the jth bit of it. So local means that just when the function to compute the ith bit of the output, you take one of the input bits either as is or complemented. That's all.
And what is d here? D.
Some fixed number, some 10. There are d such fi's. 10. 10. What I'm really wondering about, so open, is can you have one local Ramanujan graph? And we know they can be, I mean, the same paper, we show that there are three local Ramanujan graphs, so it seems possible. They can be really simple. So that's my first open problem.
Are the FIs now, matchings, or are they permutations?
Yeah, they are. So I'll tell you something about where it's coming from. Yeah.
No,
this is explicit. These functions are in P. You can compute this project. It's completely explicit. Yeah. But on top of it, there are projections.
So three local Ramanujan, this will be one of the explicit constructions, or is it? Or because you don't know others.
This will be one of, this will be one of the versions of Morgenstern's expanders with some unit. Well, let's not go into this. But yeah, of course, because I don't have a new proof of a new construction. So let me tell you about where this is coming from just by talking about Cayley expanders. And what are Cayley graphs? For Cayley graphs, you have a group H, a finite group H, and you have a subset of the group elements. It's interesting with their generating. And the G is a Cayley graph of the group H with generators S. Well, it's very simple construction. Simply the vertices of G are the elements of the group, and the edges of G are just the pairs HHS. Well, let me say S is inside H and S is S inverse, so that we have an undirected graph. H is the, you just take all these edges. You take any a group element and you map it to any place it is mapped by a set S. So S in this case will be a set of size D to keep my notation consistent there. H in H, S in S. And the question I want to ask here is which groups are expanding? Which groups are expanding? For which groups can you have Cayley graphs with fixed number of generating sets that are expanding? So that's the open problem. And I'll tell you some of what is known. Expanding. And let me make it clear that I want to say with some generating set. So again, I want a group, it's a family of groups. Maybe I should give an example. And so let me say yes and no. Some groups which are expanding and some which are not, but just to give an example here, you can take H to be SL2P. It's a family. For every prime, you have a group, right? The 2x2 matrices of determinant 1 modulo P. And you take S to be the set of matrices 1, 4 matrices 1. And it turns out that they are, you know, a family of expanders. And in fact, maybe as an exercise, you should see that if this is an expander, then this is an expander. Okay, but don't think about it now. So which groups are expanding? Abelian groups are not. And in fact, nilpotent groups, which are close to abelians, maybe you can are not. You probably know that if we should think of H being of size n, keeping our notation, here you need D must be log n. And there's a beautiful old paper of Lubotsky and Weiss Well, first of all, they ask the question whether expansion is a group property, whether, you know, if you are expanding with some generating set, you are expanding with every generating set of, you know, say, fixed size. And they also show this result with nilpotent groups, and they show that in, you know, if the central series of the, I'm not going to define it for those who know, it's the central series here, how close to abelian it is k. Then you need log, you know, k times, and the degree must be at least this.
To be counted k?
Because if k is unbounded, it's possible to make it.
Yeah, but it's k, so it's k.
What?
It's
what
a number k.
What is k?
It's k. Any number, any fixed number. If the central series is length k, it's an nilpotent of order k, then.
It's sufficient, yes?
This is a lower bound. Now here this is tight, and in fact this is tight also, but that's a non-trivial. So this is tight. And this is also tight. That's a non-trivial result of Meshulam and myself, which is emanating from something I'll tell you about in a second. What groups are expanding? Well, this group is expanding. And in fact, we know that all simple groups, all finite simple groups are expanding. How do we know that? Well, the end result here is, there are many, it's a huge story to tell the story of proofs of expansion in Kelly groups, but in Kelly graphs, but I want to note, so this result that all simple groups are expanding is basically due to Kasabov, Lubotsky, and Nikolov. They left out the Suzuki groups, but you shouldn't worry about them. They were settled also. But I want to talk really about the methods. The earliest method of proving expansion in Kelly groups is what's called the mother group approach. So here's the mother group approach. This started with Margulis and then LPS. What's the mother group approach? All these groups, for example, all these SL2Ps have a mother. What's the mother group? It's SL2Z, the Kelly, the 2x2 matrices over the integers. They are all quotients. They are all finite quotients of it. And because the SL2Z happens to have a property, but it's a deep result of Selberg's 316 theorem, it follows automatically that all these are expanding. Lubotsky asked his famous 1-2-3 problem, saying, if you replace this one on the off diagonal here by 2, it's still expanding by the same mother group argument. But if you replace it with 3, then the mother group doesn't help you. And this question led to this beautiful work of, starting with the work in arithmetic combinatorics, that's very important, and then Helfgott and Burgen-Gambold, what's called the Burgen-Gambold machine, and then lots of other work, which is the techniques is, as I said, arithmetic combinatorics, led to construction to proofs of expansion for simple groups, and this is, I'm not going to even elaborate on the techniques here that prove that all simple groups are expanding. But what other groups are expanding? Okay, we know the simple groups, we have several proofs for simple groups, but I think it's a very basic question. The only one I know, a family, is I'll describe it. But I want to say that there is just one other way I know to prove that Kelly graphs are expanding, and this is through zigzag products. So zigzag products is a graph product that was invented by Reingold, Vadan, and myself. So zigzag product, and together with Noga Alon and Alex Lubotsky, we found a way to transfer it to the algebraic setting, to the group setting, and so zigzag can work in groups through semi-direct products. Semi-direct products, and so you can build groups from other groups and maintain expansion. And I'll give you one example, which is the only example of a non-abelian group I know, the non-simple group I know that's expanding. And the open question is, you know, find other examples through these or other techniques. I think it's really interesting how expansion is connected to other group properties. The example is in a paper. By the way, this proof uses also the semi-direct product way, but it's not a constant number of generators. So we want a constant number of generators. And here is a group. The group H is the automorphism group of the tree of RETK and depth H. So you just take a tree. Every child has k neighbors. Every node has k neighbors, k children. And you do this up to some finite. So these are two finite parameters, k and h. This is a tree. What's the automorphism group? Well, you can rotate at every vertex. You can permute the nodes. This is the automorphism group. It's a far from simple group. And it is expanding. So in a paper of Rosenman, Shalev, and myself, we proved that there exists in this group of finite size, I don't know, 10. And this scaly graph is expanding. In fact, here you can build, it's clear what the mother group is. The mother group is, you just take it to infinity. And here, from the finite result, you can take some kind of an inverse limit and show that even the infinite group is expanding with a constant number of generators.
Which parameter is going to infinity?
What?
Which parameter is going to infinity?
H. It's for every k. Well, for every k large enough, I should say, bigger than 100. Okay. Questions?
Are the generators easy to describe?
Yeah, they are explicit. You give me K and H, and I give you the generator.
So at some point, you mentioned the question of whether the expansion of group depending on the choice of generators.
Yes.
So you didn't say what the answer was.
Yes, that's a good, thank you. So whether expansion is a group property. So the answer is no. In the same paper of Alon, Lubotsky, and myself, we found the first example, even though what the example should be was known in advance. Should be the symmetric group, because it's an alternating group, it's simple, and it has it's easy to see that the constant size generating sets which are not expanding. But Kasabov, and that's an important part of the result here, Kasabov found a way to, found the generating sets for the symmetric group which are expanding. So it's not a group property. But it's an interesting question for which groups all generating sets are good. Like, you know, these groups are good. Bourguin-Gambaud and then Bouillard and Gambaud showed that essentially all pairs of generators are expanding in this group. So it's a very strong group.
So I guess you have more examples here if you take groups that have something of finite index, that is one thing.
Yeah, but this is cheating.
Yes,
okay. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. So finite index is.
There's also an interesting version for most choices of generators.
Yeah. Sets. Yeah. So there's a variety, but I think the most basic questions I'm interested in is what makes a group expanding with some choice of generators. Okay. So I'm going slow, but let me continue.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there any family of groups in which you can find some constant size family of generators that make it expanding, but most constant size?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know.
Most are not.
I don't know. It's a good question. Let me proceed. So I'm here. Lossless expander. So you know, the all this talk of Ramanujan graphs and how they are optimal, you know. They are not optimal. They are optimal if you care about the second eigenvalue, but they are far from optimal if you care about expansion in the usual sense. And let me talk about vertex expansion. So, vertex expansion. So again, look at this graph of size n, and I take some subset S here. And let me assume the degree is this. So let me assume that I care just about, you know, sufficiently small sets, let's say. Sets of less than 100, 1 over 100 d fraction. Right? By how much can they expand? I want the number of neighbors, so now not edges, the number of neighbors, this is the neighbors of S, to be bigger than some, you know, see some constant times S. Well, what's the best? Certainly this constant the smallest d, the number of neighbors is not more than a factor of d of your size, right? How close to d can you get? Well, if you take Ramanujan graphs.
You want neighbors outside of S?
Yeah, but it doesn't matter at this regime, I don't care.
Between d minus 1 and d.
It doesn't matter. If you take Ramanujan graphs, it's a result of Kahale. But there are Ramanujan graphs for which C is at most D over 2. So just being Ramanujan, maybe you should look at other eigenvalues, but if just being Ramanujan is just not enough to have expansion, well, I should say. So this Ramanujan, if you take a random graph, if your graph is random, you can get very close to D. You know, C will be 1 minus epsilon, even better, but I'm writing something weak. It will be 0.999, let's say, D. It's even much better. It's close to D minus a constant. So can you do this?
Are there examples like this with JV?
Example like this? Yeah, yeah. No, he's taking a... taking a Ramanujan graph and that's to make small changes, yes.
Oh, you say 1 minus epsilon times d, that's for some sample of d is going.
Yeah, yeah. No, d is fixed.
Well, but you can't do better than d minus 1.
Yeah,
you cannot do better than d minus 1. So you won't, you can say it the way you said it, or you can say 0.9d. Epsilon, if you prefer, just
so epsilon is constant.
Yeah, but let me say simply 0.9d. If you like it better. These are 100, whatever you like. Okay. So this is my, so explicit. This is my open question. We don't know. And it's amazing that beating 1/2, which is really the issue here, is the thing that we don't know how to do. And it's also exactly the threshold of a huge number of applications. I'm not going to talk about them here, but there's a huge number of applications that depend on being, you know, 0.51. So we don't know this. You know, fortunately, we know something that's enough for all these applications, and I'll tell you about this result. This is a result Kapalbo, Reingold, Vadan, and myself, and it will lead me to the next subject there. But here's what we can do. We can do half of the problem. So we can have a bipartite graph of n nodes on this, both sides, degree d, let's say degree d on the left, which is expanding. It has this property. So if these two parts are a and b, this property holds for every subset S inside A. So if you take any set here, it expands losslessly to the other side. So this we know how to do explicitly. It's quite complex. It also uses zigzag in some variety of a zigzag product.
So you're saying only on the left, but not on the right?
Yeah, I can do it. From the right, it will be expanding normally, but not losslessly. So lossless expander will hold only from the left to the right.
The degree on the right is also bounded?
Yeah, you can make it bounded. You can make it bounded. Although the construction, you can make it bounded.
By explicit, you mean, so even weakly explicit, it's not known. There's lots of things, like polynomial time.
Yeah, no, even building the adjacency matrix, yeah, it's not known to me. but this is strongly explicit in the same sense here. And more questions. So it's, I don't know why it's so hard. Noga Alon and Mike Capalbo, let me not write it, it's because I don't want to define it, prove a weaker property than lossless expansion. If you have lossless expansion, you have unique neighbor expansion. Let me not define it. So they prove something on the way, but I think these techniques are not strong enough for lossless expansion. What is interesting in this construction and important is that you can make this smaller, let's say n over 2, and it will still have the property. So you'll have lossless expansion even though the right-hand side is smaller than the left-hand side. This is very important for the applications, okay, this ability. But the degree deteriorates as, of course, naturally, the degree deteriorates as you shrink the right-hand side. But for any constant fraction here, you'll have a constant degree. Which leads me,
Sorry, what is the smallest d, like 100? I mean,
It's like 100.
But you cannot push it like to 3 or like 5.
No. No, I mean, it's maybe 100,000. simplifying this construction would really be interesting. Go doing the n by n from some Cayley expansion. I mean, it would be really interesting, but it's beyond second eigenvalue argument. What is interesting here is pushing this smaller and smaller leads to a question that I don't have an application for. This is the unbalanced expanders. I always wanted, I envied Alex. Alex sometimes starts a talk by saying, I envy Avi, so I'll say, I envy Alex. I envy him for his 1-3 problem. So now I'll give you a 3-1 problem. Which I don't have an application for, but I'm sure it will find application.
What are the constant for zigzag?
Sorry? But zigzag is you have to put, you have to fill in the details. Zigzag is a method, so I'm not sure. The usual argument for zigzag is not lossless in any way. The arguments that come into here will resonate better with extractor people than expander people, because the zigzag is really a zigzag of extractors.
I think for lossless, D does not necessarily have to be very big, because it's a concatenation.
But the base graph is big. You start from a base graph, which is...
But then you can reduce the degree, That's right.
But I'm not sure it will maintain... No, it will not maintain losslessness. I don't think it will.
Well, depending on epsilon, so D...
That's right.
Do you know the situation of vertex expansion for these groups that you discussed? Like SL2P, does it?
Well, I don't. The main question is how do you analyze vertex expansion? This is really the question.
It should be easy. Like if you're a building group, it's just
doubling. Go for it.
It's doubling, right? If you have a set, like A plus A divided by A is a vertex expansion.
Yeah, but you want expansion which is full.
Yeah.
It's not like A plus A. You don't add two sets. You just add, Well, the A plus S, the generating. Well, if you can find a way to give this kind of estimate, that would be fantastic. We don't have methods to do that. That's a challenge. Yeah, Cayley graphs, any graphs you like. So what's my 3-1 problem? So let's say you want to push this unbalancedness farther. So let me take... N cube, well, let me call them capital N, it's better in some sense. That's the 3, that's the 2, and I care about sets here of size, of size at most N, okay? And I want you to build me a constant degree expander. D on the left, of course, on the right, the degree will be bigger because the ratio is n, such that you just want small sets to have a matching to the other side. If you allow here degree logarithmic, then it's an extractor will do the job for you. But a simple counting argument shows that a constant is enough. So randomly, it's very easy to do. Okay? And I would like an explicit construction for this. I can tell you, the question is clear. Yeah?
9 minutes.
Okay.
Maybe 7 subjects.
I'll tell you the best that I know what to do here. So it turns out that you know, these are called rate extractors, or sort of, or rate condensers, I should say. Condensers, in the same sense that Ronen talked about yesterday. What we can do, it turns out that getting in this setting, of course you can take other ratios than 3 to 1, but you can keep the ratio of the rates. You can say that, these are 3 little n bits, and these are the mapping from 3n bits to 2n bits, so ratio is 2/3. This is something that is very easy to get with constant degree. Okay, and a rate condenser, something that condenses entropy, is doing a little better. I wanted to get 2/3 plus 1/3, but if we just want this, then we know how to do it in work with Barak, Kindler, Shaltiel, Suldakov. We know how to do this. This uses arithmetic combinatorics. So this may be useful to you, but I'm really wondering about doing this. Of course, you can take 4, 5, and 1. That will be okay for me, as long as here expansion is. Okay, so let me, what now, what do I give up? It's a tough question. Let me tell you about dimensional expanders. They are so cool. And then I'm sure you will not, you will have to ask me about super expanders in the question. So here's one way to define expanders. So we had these FIs, these maps, they are probably permutations. So one way to define an expander is to say that you have these FIs, there are maybe permutations or functions. And what you have is that for every set S of size at most 1/2, there exists an I, one of these maps, which moves it out of S. So if you take FI of S, intersects with S, this is most 1 minus C. Same C as there, roughly, or maybe a slightly different C times S. Right? That's an equivalent, if you don't care about the exact constant. That's equivalent to the definition of expander. Now, what's a dimension expander? It's like in many combinatorics problems, you just take sets to vector spaces and size to dimension. So let's do it here. What will be the analog? The analog will be a dimension expander. It's a definition we made with Boaz Barak, Amir Shpilka, Russell in Paliazzo, Amir Shpilka. And so we now look for TI, linear maps. And now what do we want? They act on some space, so these are permutations on N. And here we will TI maps on, let's say, F to the N. Okay. are maps of epsilon. So linear maps, what do we want for them? For every vector space. What?
To itself.
To itself. Yeah, also there it's to itself. We do everything, we just copy and make it linear algebraic. For every vector space, in F to the n, of what do we have to copy? The dimension is at most a half. There is an I, there is one of these linear transformations, which again moves this vector space significantly. Ti of V intersects V. When we look at the dimension of this, is at most 1 minus C, dimension of S, V. Okay, exactly the... Well, we made this conjecture and then... well, okay, I should say, for any field, take random linear maps, 10 of them, they do the job. Okay, so again, random is easy. And explicit, I made the following conjecture, and actually in a lecture I gave in IPAM, which is still open, so that will probably be my last thing. The conjecture was the following. What could be the source of such linear maps? There's an obvious guess. You know, you take Cayley expanders and you take an irreducible representation and take these matrices that are coming from the expanding generator. So if G is a group and S is a, or maybe I should say H. H is a group and this is an expanding generating set. And suppose there is some irreducible representation of G, of H, over the field F. So we want a field F. We want the dimension n. So suppose it has some dimension which we call n, dimension of 4 is n. Then we can take t sub little s to be simply rho of little s for all s in s. And the conjecture is that this is a dimension expander. Now I made the everybody's clear. So it's a natural way to get, you know, D matrices from a D regular Cayley expander. I made this conjecture in a talk, and both Alex Lubotsky and Zelmanov were in the audience. And they sort of jumped after the. Alex doesn't remember.
No, we didn't jump.
Yeah, it's against Alex's principles to jump, but you could see in his, both of them came immediately after the talk. Say we really can do it. I mean, this is true.
Just took 3 months.
Yeah, it's because they've been working for a year on a project that. Anyway, so Lubotsky and Zelmanov actually proved it. Over C, over the complex numbers. So it's true. That's and the question of other fields remained open for a while, and I'll just tell you that it was resolved, so I have no open question here. But the open question is applications of this wonderful object. But it was, I just want to say that it was resolved in two completely different ways using two ingenious things, one by Burgen and Yordaev via monotone expanders that I'm not going to define. That's one solution. So these are all for every.
Via your conjecture.
No, they don't. Yeah, actually, very good. So there is an open question. Prove the conjecture or disprove it. Maybe you should look only at the semi-simple case where size of H and the characteristic of the field are relatively prime. But I would make this conjecture here. But I just want to mention that it was resolved in two ways, via monotone expanders and by Forbes and Guruswamy using something called subspace space designs. And I'll encourage you to find out about this. So
this is,
yeah, I'm sorry, I knew that if I'll write the names of everybody, I will get up. This is the Burgen and Yordaev, and this is Forbes and Guruswamy. So So it works for every. So yeah, and Anup is threatening me. Thank you. Good question. So let me tell you, the definition is. Well, you are the chair, you know.
That question maybe we'll save for the longer version of the talk. Is there a short question?
So let me not write anything down, but no, this way I. Super expanders are. So regular expanders, another way to define them is that they have a Poincaré inequality for L2. I'm not going to write it down, it says something to some of you. And the question is, what happens if you want a Poincaré inequality for every norm or for every uniformly convex norm? This comes from a very important subject in topology, Novikov conjecture, and various things I'm not going to talk about and I know nothing about. And the question is whether every expander is a super expander. There are explicit constructions of super expanders, but the question is whether everyone is like that.
Okay, maybe we'll take the rest of the questions offline. We'll reconvene at 10:25.